Hello friends, welcome to a new lecture today on tuberculosis of genital tract. So tuberculosis of genital tract, whether tuberculosis can be of genital tract or anywhere, it is mainly caused by mycobacterium tuberculosis. And this is 95%, whereas few cases by mycobacterium bovis, which is only 5%. How are you going to stain this mycobacterium tuberculosis? It is stained by zeal nail stain, acid fast stain, or it can also be zeal nail stain or acid fast stain. So this genital tuberculosis, it is most commonly secondary to primary focus. So primary focus being lung, and sometimes it can also occur from lymph nodes or also from the GIT. Okay, now once the genital tract is colonized, so there is first granuloma formation, and then there is caseous necrosis, then there is fibrosis. So obviously there are three main stages: one, granuloma, next caseous necrosis, and then finally causing fibrosis. So active growth occurs, and also whenever there is TB genital tract, so that can also cause active growth of the mycobacterium tuberculosis bacteria occurs. So primary genital tuberculosis is rare. Always and always, most commonly, it occurs due to secondary bacterial tuberculosis. There is a rare case which was said that in some areas where saliva is used as a lubrication just prior to intercourse by some men. So whenever saliva is used as a lubrication prior to intercourse by some men, if the saliva contains mycobacterium tuberculosis bacilli due to primary pulmonary infection, then there is a chance of infection spreading it to the genital tract. Okay, now this genital tract infection, it is most common in fallopian tubes. In the fallopian tubes, it occurs in 90 to 100% of the cases. It first starts in fallopian tubes, and then it also occurs next. It will spread to endometrium, where it occurs in 50 to 60% of the cases. Then it occurs in ovaries, where it occurs in 20 to 30% of the cases. Then it can occur in cervix, which is 5 to 15%, and then finally vulva and vagina, which is least common, and here it occurs to less than 1%. Okay, the pathology of the tuberculosis bacilli is similar to that of normal pathology in the lung. So I'm not going to deal with the pathogenesis of this tubercular bacilli. So let us continue with the genital tract lesions. So in the genital tract lesions, first I would like to start with fallopian tube. In the fallopian tube, mostly it is involvement of tubes is nearly 100%, and it is bilateral. And it is most commonly secondary to the primary focus. Primary focus most commonly being lung or lymph node, as I have said. The tubal mucosa, which is there, that will act as a nidus for blood spread. So in salpingitis, that is in fallopian tube infection, it is most commonly bilateral. Sometimes it can even spread to the ovary by transluminal spread. The fallopian tube, in the beginning, it appears normal, and later, whenever there is minimal disease, in mild cases there can be appearance of thickened. The fallopian tube is thickened, so there is thickened fallopian tube, and it feels like whip-like consistency. This looks like whip-like consistency, so that is one thing which you have to see. And later you will see that you'll see that there are tubercles on the surface of fallopian tube. Whenever there are tubercles on the surface of the fallopian tube, this looks like a tubercular salpingitis. Okay, so whenever there is, this is the fallopian tube. On the fallopian tube, there are many tubercles, right? There are many tubercles. So because of this tubercles, the ampullary part which is there, it is dilated, and this will give rise to the appearance of tobacco pouch appearance. tobacco pouch appearance. The reason of this tobacco pouch appearance is dilatation of ampulla. Ampulla is dilated, resulting in tobacco pouch appearance. There are even studs, tubercles which are studded in the fallopian tube surface. On the fallopian tube surface, the tubes are enlarged. Okay, later the tubes are enlarged and there is adhesions. Then you see enlarged tubes, and now there is formation of fibers, so fibrous tissue, and as a result there are adhesion formation in the tubes. Okay, and there is also, if you see the cut section, you see that there is yellowish gray caseous matter. You'll see yellowish gray caseous material which is seen on cut section. Okay, then slowly the whole tube, there is fibrosis occurs in the tube. Later there is fibrosis occurs in the tube, and finally the tubes are occluded. Fibrosis occurs in the tube and the tubes are occluded. Okay, the most common part occurring, the most common site which is involved in this tuberculosis is ampullary part. Ampullary part is most commonly involved. Okay, if there is exosalpinx involvement, that is outside the salpinx, if it is involved, so this is what happens. Then if there is endosalpinx involvement, so this will cause hyperplasia of the cells, and also in the cells there are tuberculous granuloma. Okay, so this is what happens when there is endosalpinx involvement. The diagnosis, it is simply by demonstration of acid fast bacilli in the testis, sorry, in the tissues. You can also do PCR in the samples, and so this is how you diagnose the lesions. Now what about the uterus? What happens in the tuberculosis of uterus? In the uterus, the lesions, what are the lesions that you see in the uterus? In the uterus, if you see the endometrial histology, first the endometrium, so this is the uterus. Now the endometrium, this endometrium occurs unremarkable. This looks normal. On grossly, it looks completely normal earlier stages, and later if you do a histology, you will see central caseation, and which is surrounded by epithelioid cells, and stroma has giant cells. So these are seen on histology. And occasionally, if you see the endometrium, in the endometrium you see either ulcerative lesions or sometimes granular lesions are seen, granular, or sometimes even fungating lesions are seen. So different types of lesions are seen in the endometrium. Okay, and then later, once this progresses, this will progress to fibrosis, and because of fibrosis, there is fibrosis, and because of the fibrosis, this ostea, the tubal ostea, these are narrowed. Because of fibrosis, and the cavity is also shrunken because of fibrosis. And finally, there is complete destruction of endometrium, and this will lead to amenorrhea. Sometimes you can even see that the extensive uterine adhesions are seen. Sometimes there can be extensive uterine adhesions can be formed, and this formation of extensive uterine adhesions, this is called as Asherman syndrome. This can also occur. Okay, then what happens in ovaries? In ovaries, you see that there is ovary spread. It can spread from the adjacent fallopian tubes. So here you see perioophoritis is seen. And even here you see caseous granulomas are seen. And even caseating granulomas are seen in the ovary. And then in the cervix. In the cervix, now if you see what happens. In the cervix, you will see sometimes there can be a polypoid lesion, or there can be a growth, simple growth can be there, or sometimes there can be polypoid lesion, or sometimes there can be an ulcer. Okay, microscopically, always there is granulomas are seen. Granulomas are seen microscopically. But on examination, you can see an ulcer, or you can even see hyperplasia of granular epithelium. Hyperplasia of epithelium leading to the formation of papillae. So you can either see an ulcer, or you can see a papillar papilliform growth can be seen. So the diagnosis, for diagnosis you can do cervical biopsy and send it for histology. Okay, this is what is done in cervix. Next, what happens in vagina? In vagina and vulva, here this is rare. The infection of the vulva and vagina with tuberculosis, it is rare. And you can occur here, there can be even exogenous infection by sexual intercourse. This can occur either through renal tuberculosis, or if the man is suffering with men has TB epididymitis, even then there is a chance of getting tuberculosis through sexual intercourse. Next, you will see in the vulva, you will see that there is a discharging ulcer or sinus or nodular hypertrophy can be seen. Irrespective of the type of lesions, microscopically you see there may be caseous necrosis surrounded by granulomatous cells, and also giant cells and lymphocytes. So always, irrespective of the type of the lesion, you see these lesion. Irrespective of the site, you see microscopically always you see the granulomas and also caseous necrosis. Okay, and irrespective of the site, you will also see presence of caseating necrosis, which can be followed to fibrous lesions at the end. Okay, and if in vagina, you will see TB vaginitis. Okay, ulcers, and these ulcers later heal by fibrosis, and they will lead to vaginal stenosis. So these are the different pathological features which occur in tuberculosis. Thank you guys for watching my lecture. In my next class, I'll explain about the clinical features of TB, genital TB. Thank you for watching my lecture.